Let me begin by thanking the Infosys Science Foundation and the team which has been working for that to make this visit possible. Giving a series of lectures in Bangalore and Trivandrum, and I think most of the credit should go to the team for organizing it all. So I know that most of you don't do cosmology, so let me begin on a very reassuring note. Cosmology is very simple, okay? And what this guy is doing here right now is one of the two things. You have the structure of physical laws, what physicists call the laws of nature, and then at the other end, you have the structure of the universe. So most of the time, you are doing one of the two things. The first is, you use the known structure of the physical laws to explain the structure of the universe. That is very exciting, because from what we know about physical laws, tested in the laboratory, we have tested it up to something like 100 GeV in LHC. You can understand the universe from a billionth of the second since the Big Bang to for 14 billion years. This is a creditable achievement by anybody's imagination. We can do that. This is directly observation-driven cosmology. But what is really, really fun is not this. What is really, really fun is the other way around. Because here is where cosmology offers a unique opportunity. You can test laws of physics up to a particular energy in the laboratory. Right now it is 100 GeV. That goes up to 1 billionth of the second since Big Bang. But all the really interesting questions happened before that 1 billionth of the second. How did this universe come into being? How did everything we see in it came into being? So in order to do that, you have to model something. You have to model the physical theories and then use the what we know about the universe to test the structure of the physical laws. So this opportunity doesn't exist in any laboratory physics, because we won't be able to reach this kind of energies in any time in the future. Therefore, we want to use the universe as the biggest laboratory we have got, and in fact you can't imagine something bigger, and test it, use it to test the physical laws. So if you want to understand that, as I said, this is the really exciting thing, and this is what I'm going to talk about. You have to first understand what is the structure of the physical laws which we have, and how do we put together the picture which we have about the universe, what are the unsolved questions which come from that, and how do we go from there, okay? So the first part, I will talk about the known universe, and how do we sort of put together the laws of physics and the structure of the universe. So let me begin with the structure of physical laws, or the laws of physics. One nice way to think about this is to take three fundamental constants, which all of you have heard of. One is the Newton's constant, which comes in gravity. The other is something called Planck constant, which comes up in the case of quantum theory. And the other is the speed of light, which comes in relativity. Now, it is just for technical reasons, it is more convenient to think in terms of 1 by c rather than c. So these are the three axes of a cube. And then you want to ask, where do the kind of physics which you guys have studied at some stage in life fall in this picture? So these are sort of, think of it as a unit cube. And let us see where these things fall. First of all, if you start from the origin and you switch on the Newtonian gravitational constant. So you have got gravity in your hand, but you don't have speed of light, you don't have quantum theory. Then what you get is the standard Newtonian mechanics. And this rules over the macro world. All planetary motion, for example, is understandable from Newtonian gravity. This is the universal law of attraction between material bodies. You can go one step further, and instead of this vertical line, you can go along the horizontal direction. You start from the origin, you went up like this, now you go in this direction. And what you get here is what is known as special theory of relativity of Einstein, which he came up in 1905. This did something revolutionary. One, something all of you know of, it said E is equal to mc square. That is, the energy and mass are interconvertible, and there is a conversion factor which you can write down. The other thing which it did, which you may or may not be aware of, is that it sort of linked together space and time. Before relativity came along, people used to think that space is one entity and time is what you measure in the watch. Now it turned out that after special relativity, we realized that if you move, your clocks run slower. So your spatial movement and the time duration or inextricably linked. So the space and time came together into a form called space-time. This was something else which happened with special relativity. Okay, so I have moved in this direction, I have moved in this direction, now let me move in this direction. When you switch on this H-cross, what you get is something known as quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics describes the micro world, the very small scales, atoms, molecules, entire chemistry comes out of quantum theory. And this, many people have contributed to it. And the most important thing, which probably some of you would have heard of, is something called uncertainty principle. Classically, if I throw a ball up, I can measure its position and its speed simultaneously. Quantum mechanics tells you that you can't do that. There are certain variables which you can't measure simultaneously with arbitrary accuracy. There is something called uncertainty principle which governs. So we went up, went this way, and went this way. Now what we want to do is to take two steps at a time. Suppose I switch on gravity and switch on the special relativity. How do I combine the principles of Newtonian gravity with the principles of Einstein's relativity? This is what took 10 years for Einstein, from 1905 to 1915, and we are celebrating the centenary year of that next year. What he showed was that what you thought was gravitational force is just the curvature of a space-time. So suppose you have a very massive body, it just curves the space-time around it. If you put another body here, it will just roll down. And you mistakenly think of it as a gravitational attraction between these two. So it is the curvature of the space-time, the wrapping of the space-time, which describes gravity. And he also told you that if there is some amount of energy or mass density, they are equivalent, in the space, it is related to the curvature which it is produced, the radius of curvature of some sphere which you attach here, by this relation. So the more density you have, the more sharply curved things would be. The less density you have, the flatter it will look. This is something which Einstein told you. And for our purpose, the important thing is that it also predicts that the universe is expanding. It tells you that the universe doubles its size in a time scale which is of the order of this curvature divided by speed of light. So when the universe was very small, when the universe was 1 second old, it was doubling its size every second. Now it is 14 billion years old, it is very tired, it has been around for a long, long time, and it doubles its size in every 1 billion years. So the time scale and the age of the universe is related, and this is another thing which general relativity tells you. We also need to know a few more things in order to put this picture together. So just as I went like this, I can switch on this H-cross and this. That is, I can switch on quantum mechanics and relativity. And that leads to something called quantum field theory. This is one of the main things about quantum field theory, is that what you think of emptiness, nothing, the vacuum, is bristling with activity. This is an artist's caricature of that. There are particles and antiparticles and energies which are coming into being and annihilating each other and vanishing back. And there is a sort of a continuous activity in what we would have naively thought is nothing. That is called vacuum fluctuations. This is also predicted that for every particle there is an antiparticle. This is commercial now. Whenever you go, hopefully you don't have to, but whenever you go for a PET scan, PET scan, that P stands for something called positron, which is an antiparticle of electron, of which atoms are made. So antiparticles have medical applications. And the standard model of particle physics is built on this. So what if I switch all the three on, quantum mechanics, gravity, and speed of light? You get something where I still don't have a picture to put. This leads to what is known as quantum gravity, where you are bringing together the principles of quantum theory and gravity. Nobody has succeeded in doing it yet. But the important thing is, we need it in cosmology. If you want to understand what the universe did before that first 1 billionth of the second, you need to have some ideas about quantum gravity. It is also important to look at the cosmology and see whether there are relics of quantum gravity lying around there. Remember that the highest energies in the universe can be probed only at the earliest moments, and there has to be relics coming from that. So this is what we believe the structure of physical laws are. Now let me switch gears and talk about the structure of the universe and merge them together. So what about the universe? Compared to this, that is very simple. The first thing you think of when you think about universe is sun and planetary system going around it. This is the picture of the nearby region of the sun. This is about 10 light years. And this is Alpha Centauri, which is, I'm sure some of you would know, there must be Sirius somewhere here. Here is Sirius. And there is a whole lot of stars around it. If you really scoop out and you go to something like 1,000 light years being this, you will start seeing the stars distributed in patterns like this. Some of these stars you might again recognize are Betelgeuse, or what we call Arudra in our Indian parlance. Go a bit further, something very dramatic emerges. This is the picture of our galaxy with all these spiral arms. And sun is somewhere here, just circulating around it, sun's location, which is circulating around this. These galaxies are the basic structures out of which the universe is built of. Galaxies are to the cosmology like molecules or atoms are to the condensed matter physicists. So if you look near our Milky Way galaxy, this is our galaxy in which we live, the nearest galaxy is an Andromeda galaxy. And then there are a huge number of these galaxies around it. So Andromeda galaxy, this is a real picture of the Andromeda galaxy. And in a clear sky with the binoculars, you can see something like this. This is up in the sky, and this is the nearest large galaxy to Milky Way galaxy. So here's a zoo of galaxies for you. And we have seen billions of them. And they come in all varieties, colors, shapes, etc., etc. And as I said, they are distributed in a very gigantic web, what we call the cosmic web, in the universe. So this is like 100 million light years is just this line. And the structures which you see here are real. These sort of filamentary structures with voids in between, etc., that is how galaxies are distributed. And the first task of cosmologists is to explain where all these came from. Where did they all come from? And why is it distributed like that? Why is it not distributed very regularly like a cube? Or why is it not distributed completely randomly? Okay, it is doing neither, and we need to understand that. So let us go a bit further. And okay, if you really have eyes for the galaxies, not for the stars, sky would be wonderful. This is what you will see. This is a real photograph. It is not artist impression. So this is built together from what is known as APM technology. And this is projecting all the galaxies which we know into a region of the sky. And this is what you will see. And the color coding is real. That is the colors of the galaxies. So there are over a million galaxies in this, all projected. Suppose you don't want to project, but you want to look in the real life, then it is pizza slice. So you are here, and you go along this slice. When you go along this way, you are going further and further in distance. And this is one angle, and the other angle is compass. So think of it like a slice of pizza. And this is artificial color coding. These are high density regions. These are low density regions. But you can clearly see the structures, empty regions and filamentary regions. This is how galaxies are distributed. So the first thing which we want to ask is how much of them is there? I mean, how much of this matter is floating around in this universe? Can we measure its density? If I distribute all of them smoothly, what density will it give? And how did these structures form? So let us look at that. In order to do that, I want to introduce one key parameter in the universe, which is usually denoted by the Greek letter omega. It essentially measures the relative strength between the speed with which the universe is expanding and the amount of gravity which is trying to pull it back. So you normalize things in such a way that if omega is equal to 1, the universe will just expand to a maximum size and recollapse again. Omega less than 1, it will continue to expand forever. Okay, that is the way this is defined. So you want to compute how much is the omega contributed by different things in the universe. So you start by first measuring all that which is out there. Okay, every visible structure in the universe, you measure that and you add them up. And you see how much do you get. You get about 5%. Okay, so it is woefully inadequate to make the universe sort of stop and then recollapse. It will continue to expand forever. This one is a kind of a magical figure. That is what one would have expected to get. But you get only somewhere much less than that, about 5% if you take all the visible matter in the universe. But of course, the first question you want to ask is, wait a second, is there in the universe more matter than that which meets your eye? The surprising answer is yes, there is a lot more. And you can actually measure it by indirect effect. So here is an example. Here is a galaxy, and nature has conveniently given us some hydrogen clouds, tiny hydrogen clouds, which orbit around the galaxy just like planets orbit around the sun. Just as by measuring the speed with which planets are moving, I can measure the mass of the sun, you can measure the total amount of mass which is inside from the test particles which are going around. When you do that, you find the amount of matter is denoted by a curve like this. And if you just take the visible matter, what you can see, what emits light, it is like this. So there is a huge deficit. This deficit is because there is matter in this galaxy which is dark, which does not emit light, which is there, it gravitates, it contributes to gravity, but it does not emit light. This is known as dark matter. I want to show you just one more dramatic visual effect of this dark matter. Look at this picture, and you don't even have to look very sharply. You can sort of see arc-like structures here, right? There is some arc-like structure here, there is some arc-like structure here. What are these arcs? These arcs are distant galaxies, the light from which is going through a nearby cluster of galaxies. Now, this cluster of galaxies plus the dark matter surrounding it is bending the light which is coming from away, because Einstein's theory, all energy is mass, and you know that matter is acted by gravity, so light is also acted by gravity. It acts like a distorting lens, and that distortion is what you see here, this arc-like structure. By measuring how much is this distortion, you can measure how much matter is there out there. This measures everything which is out there and gravitating, not just the visible matter. And if you do all that, along with those rotation curves of galaxies which I showed you, you end up finding that the dark matter contributes up to 25%. So 25% is dark matter, 5% is normal matter. We have got 30. Keep that number in mind. We were hoping that we'll get one, but we got only 30. And this is where things sort of stood in the late 80s and early 90s. If you take this much of matter and you plot it, the density of the normal matter will decrease as the universe expands. And the amount of dark matter is, of course, something like 5% and 25%, about 5 times larger. It will be slightly above, and that will also decrease, and the universe will keep expanding. There is a third component to the universe, which I have sort of symbolically shown here. It appears as though the entire universe is sitting inside a microwave oven, and that oven is kept at a temperature 2.73 Kelvin. Okay. Where is this coming from? This is a direct link from the Big Bang. The hot Big Bang, as it cooled, the radiation in that started cooling. At some stage, the radiation decoupled from the rest of the matter. This happened when the universe was about 1,000 times smaller than its current size. And that radiation is all around us, and we can see it. In fact, if you have a bad TV, you can see it very well. If you have an old-fashioned TV with the two antennas, and if you tune between two stations, 1% of the snow you see in that is due to direct interaction with the Big Bang. This microwave background radiation is what you will pick up at 1% level. So this is all around us, and this can be detected. And this is giving us messages right from the time when the universe was 1,000 times smaller. None of the structures I described to you existed. It is really primordial. So if you add that radiation, its energy density falls much faster than the other two, which I told you about, which means that very early on, they would have crossed, and this would have been dominating. But now it has sort of died down. And this is the matter which is dominating today. What is important in this picture is that there is a critical point at which the energy of the matter and the energy of the radiation will be equal. And you can calculate how much density is there. It's a pure number. What that number is not important for this kind of a talk, but there is a pure number which you can compute, and theory can explain that number. High energy physics can tell you if it knows various parameters, which they don't right now. But in principle, you can figure out this number. Remember this number. We will come back to that. Okay. This is all fine. I have told you that there is normal matter, there is dark matter, and there is radiation. And then there is all these cosmic structures which we see. Where did these structures come from? That is the first question which a cosmologist should ask. So the easiest way to do that is to just make a universe. So I'll show you how to make a universe. Here it is. It's being made right before your eyes. You start with a computer simulation where you put small density inhomogeneity. Some regions have more density, some regions have less density. Let it run by gravity. Nothing else, no other hanky-panky, and it gives you something like this. So you can start with a initial distribution. Let me do this again. You start with an initial distribution where there are small inhomogeneities. Gravity can enhance it. Rich will get richer and poor will get poorer. And it will form structures like the structures which we see. So what we need is gravity acting on some initial density fluctuations which are present in the universe. So there are only two things which you need to understand. First is, how do we test this? It's all wonderful for me to run a computer simulation in a box and then say this is how universe got formed. Did it really get formed that way? Fortunately, we can test this. Because we are very fortunate as cosmologists that we can look into our past and into the universe past. The point is that when I look at you, I don't see you as you are right now. I see you as you were a fraction of the second earlier, because light takes that much of time to come here. When I look at sun, I see the sun as it was 8 minutes earlier. We can actually see the universe when it was 300,000 years old. Today it is like 14 billion years old. I can see a very young universe because light from that is what is coming to me as this cosmic microwave background radiation at 2.7 Kelvin. Well, actually, it is not as smooth as the smooth 2.7 Kelvin. If you look very, very closely, which we have been doing for the last 20 years or so, you will find structures in it. This means that there were tiny fluctuations in the universe when the universe was 1,000 times smaller. The difference in this fluctuation scale is few parts in a million, and thanks to technology, we can now measure it. In fact, it's very dramatic. These tiny wiggles are a gold mine of information, and we have been targeting it like anything since 1992. This is the kind of resolution we had in 1992. This is what we had in 2003. This is what we had in 2013, and is going to improve. So sheer technology has helped us to see the universe as it was when it was young. And with these wiggles, we can do a lot. Now you have to ask, how do I quantify the wiggles? So I don't want to do anything technical in this talk, but this graph, unfortunately, is needed. What this graph tells you on this axis is the difference in temperature. I said it is not uniform, and there is this temperature difference between this point and this point. So if I take two directions in the sky, measure the temperature difference, then I average over the sky keeping my hands at the same angular separation. So at something like, I take a given angular scale, say 0.2 degrees, and I ask how much is the average temperature difference, this is the value you get in some units. So for every angular scale from 0.07 degrees to something like 0.5 degrees, I know how the temperature is varying. What I want you to keep in your mind is the fantastic agreement between the observed points and a theoretical curve. We will come to what this theoretical curve is in a moment, but you see the fit. A cosmological model fits this data so accurately, and using that, we can understand a lot about the universe. Now we have to understand two questions. We have pushed it back to this. Fine, there are these small fluctuations, and computer simulation tells you that you can get the universe out of it. But where did these density fluctuations come from? And also, can this actually lead to the kind of structures which we see? So here is this fluctuations in the CMBR, and there are two things which you want to do. Where did it come from? We now know the answer. It turns out that they came from tiny fluctuations in the very early universe. So this is why I introduced this to you very early on. The vacuum or the nothing is a place with huge amount of activity in quantum field theory. There are energy density fluctuations in the vacuum. In the very early universe, there were these fluctuations, and these fluctuations grew, and they became these fluctuations which we actually see in the universe. How do I know that? Because if I put the correct kind of fluctuations here, I end up getting correct kind of fluctuations here. Then you drive these fluctuations by what I already told you, by computer simulations, and you find that these structures form. Now you get a lot of information about the universe both in this path and in this path. So I want to spend some time explaining this and explaining this. So let us start with this path. So here are the vacuum fluctuations in the very early universe, and that led to these structures which you see observationally. Now in order to do that, if you want to get this right, it turns out that you need something very peculiar, some things which we hate in our politics, an inflationary phase in the very early epoch of the universe. Before this 1 billionth of the second, there has to be a phase where the universe went through a very rapid expansion. So what do I mean by this inflationary phase? In order to do that, let us go back to that graph of the energy density of the universe versus the size of the universe. I showed you that there was radiation and there is matter. Let's forget normal matter for the moment, this is good enough. And there is the total cosmic density tracking the red line. In order to produce the fluctuations which we see and to get the correct vacuum fluctuations, it is necessary that there is a phase here where the density in the universe almost remains constant. So when the density remains constant, the curvature scale remains the constant, the doubling time remains constant. This is like investing in national security certificates, not that anybody does it any longer. It will double at the same period of time, and it will keep doubling. So because nothing is diluting it, so the universe will expand exactly at the same level. And that leads to a very accelerated phase of expansion of the universe. Normally, as the universe expands, the densities die down. Because the densities die down, your rate of interest drops. As a result of it, the amount by which the things grow is going to decrease. But that is a decelerated expansion of the universe. When the densities remain constant, the universe is in an accelerated phase of expansion. And this is the inflationary phase in the early universe. And this picture I showed you implies that this existed. And it can tell you, give you information about this. For our purpose, it now introduces a second density. The density of the universe at this phase. Remember, I originally gave you another density, so now I have two numbers to play around with. Okay? And I need to explain both of them. Fortunately, the high energy physics, in principle, can explain both these. So we have ideas as to what these two numbers are. So we know how the early universe was formed at this stage, how various density fluctuations occur, and how it went then. So that part is reasonably under control. One would have thought that is the part which is more uncertain because you are talking about very early universe. But it turned out that that part is simple and you can control it. Now let us get to this. You have these fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background radiation. And I told you it went through a gravitational instability, which is the technical term for that computer simulation which I showed you, where things sort of grew, form structures like this. Now you can do this with different kinds of universes. You can put different kinds of dark matter, you can put different amount of total energy and all that. So you start with the same picture, that you can't tinker because that comes from observation, that is data. And then you can do all kinds of things in between and then get different kinds of universes, one for every day in your computer. Then you compare it with what you have really out there. And that tells you what kind of matter and how much of it is present in the universe. So we did this somewhere around early 90s. It was going on since late 80s, early 90s, and that led to a major surprise. This is something which no theoretician wanted, but this is the way our university is built. It has this about 5% of normal matter, what I call atoms. Then I told you that it has about 24-25% of dark matter. That was known for a long time. But we didn't know what was filling the rest and whether there is anything more at all. Maybe the total omega is only 0.3 and the universe will expand forever. People were willing to live with that. It turned out that this rest of the part, nearly 71%, and the total omega is 1, the rest of the pi is filled by something called cosmological constant. I will describe in more detail what cosmological constant is, but to connect with what you might have read in popular literature, this is what people used to call dark energy. Okay, that is another name. Now, the dark energy could be various things, but there is really convincing evidence in the last 5 years that it is just this cosmological constant. So, I am going to just latch on to this. So, cosmological constant is a constant you add in Einstein's theory, and using that, you can explain all the phenomena here. That is, given this cosmological constant. This curve I showed you, where the observations fit the theory so beautifully, is done with this composition. You tinker with this composition, this fit goes away. So, observations tell you what is in the universe and how the structures came along. It is no longer a theoretician's game. You don't have leeway, you don't have elbow room. This is what the universe is, whether you like it or not. If you don't like it, get out of the universe. So, this universe need to be explained, and in particular, we need to understand where this came from. But again, we are generally skeptical sort of people. Okay, this is good, you are getting it from this curve, but is there a direct way of testing it? Again, fortunately, you can. Because if there is a cosmological constant in the universe, contributing nearly 70% of the energy, called as dark energy, then it will accelerate the expansion of the universe. This is exactly like the inflationary phase. In the inflationary phase, there was a constant energy density and the universe was accelerating. In the late stages, like today, now, right now, there is another constant energy density coming from this cosmological constant, which is just a term in Einstein's equation which acts like a density, and that is also going to accelerate the expansion of the universe. So, if I test the universe, nothing else can accelerate the universe because the all other material energy densities just drop. So, if we can figure out whether the universe is accelerating, then I am through. But that I can, because I have been stressing that the further you look into the universe, the earlier you are seeing. So, all that I have to do is to look further and further and further and see whether the universe was expanding with the same speed as it is expanding today. Was it expanding faster? Was it expanding slower? If it was expanding faster, it is decelerating. If it was expanding slower and it is expanding faster now, it is accelerating. So, you just make a direct measurement. There is a tiny problem with this. If you want to see further and further and you want to get light from it, things become dimmer and dimmer. So, you need some very bright sources very far away in order to run this. Again, technology comes to your rescue. We couldn't have done it 20 years back. With the Hubble Space Telescope, you could see very far away into the universe and you could do this test. So, the fortunate thing, the beams or these very powerful beacons which we have are called supernova. Now, there are, if you have stars which form and a very large star just evolves, in the end stages, it explodes in a gigantic explosion, and this is the picture of what is known as a Crab supernova. And this was an explosion which was recorded by Chinese astronomers in 1054. And it was also recorded in America by the Red Indians. It's surprising. 1054 was the heydays of the Chola Kingdom in South, and this happened on July 4th. They must have had a really heavy monsoon because there is absolutely no record of this in Indian writings during Chola days. But here it is, this explosion, and this, when this happens, you can see it during daytime. And this supernova went off in our galaxy. Then you can see it in the daytime. It is 8 times brighter than Venus, which you might have seen. And it lasts, with naked eye, you can see it for a couple of, nearly a year and a half. That is what Chinese astronomers did. So if you have such supernova, now we can see the supernova in other galaxies, faraway galaxies. So using them, we can measure the rate at which the universe was expanding, and this is what you get. This is just observational data from supernova plotted against a theory. Now, you don't have to be a genius to figure out that the speed of expansion of the universe is increasing. It was decreasing nicely up to a point, then it started increasing when the universe was about 60% the current size. Very recently, it started increasing. Speed increasing means it is accelerating. So the universe is accelerating today. So this acceleration in turn means that the density, the cosmic density of the universe is going to a constant value. As I told you, remember national savings certificates. If it is keep increasing, doubling up at the same rate, it means there is a constant rate of interest. And here it is a constant density. So there is a constant density phase to which the universe is going through. So if you put these things together, this picture, this constant density, is coming from what I call the cosmological constant. So I want to spend a little bit of time on that, because that is the key part of the last part of the talk. So what is this cosmological constant, which is driving the accelerated expansion of the universe, which we see today right before our eyes? Now, there are various ways of looking at it. The simplest way is that it is just a mathematical term in Einstein's equation. But it has a strange, it is just a term, okay? It is just something which you add to the equation, a constant term. It has this peculiar property that effectively it acts like some material with negative pressure. Normally the objects which we see all have positive pressure. So if I have a balloon and I have gas in it, and it has positive pressure, when the balloon expands, the gas is doing work against the skin of the balloon and it will cool down. But if balloon had negative pressure gas, then when it expands, it can actually heat up. And if it adjusts things properly, then it can just make sure that the temperature remains constant and doesn't cool. What the cosmological constant does is something like that. As the universe expands, it doesn't dilute itself, it remains as a constant density. And it does this accelerated expansion of the universe in the nearby thing. Almost every theoretician agree that this is the most important puzzle in theoretical physics today. We don't understand it. Okay, the question is, where did this come from? Nobody wanted it. Observation trusted it on us from 1998 onwards, and now it is very well established. So mathematically, graphically, what does it do? If you look at the nearby region, forget inflation for a minute. So you have dark matter and you had the radiation and they were together at this point, equal density. Now I have said that there is another density to the universe, the dark energy density or the cosmological constant density, which stays constant. It's like a sleeper agent. And as these densities start dropping below that, it starts dominating. So the total energy density of the universe, the red line, tracks that now. This is what is happening today. Now, if I put this together, there is a equality, rho eq, where there is one density, and here is another rho lambda. If I put them all together, then you find that there are three densities in the universe. So the entire dynamics of the universe can be described if you know the numerical values of these three. And as I told you, I know the value of this and I know the value of this somewhat from high energy. From G, H, and C, the three fundamental constants we started the lecture with, one coming from gravity, another coming from quantum theory, and the third one coming from relativity, you can form a quantity with the dimension of length square, so that this product is a pure number. It could be 13, it could be 14, it could be 1. When you compute it, observationally, using the known value of lambda, is an extraordinarily tiny number, but non-zero. It is 1 followed by 123 zeros,
1 by that. Okay? It's an extraordinarily tiny number. Theoretically, we we have no clue where this number is. So this is the problem of the cosmological constant. There are three densities with
like a technical term, but this is something which all of you are familiar with. Elasticity is an emergent phenomenon. If I take this and I bend it, it has some elastic vibrations, elasticity, and or if I have a cantilever beam and I oscillate it. All engineers use these things. And there is a theory of elasticity. But what is elasticity? There is no such thing as elasticity. The steel bar is made of atoms and molecules. So if I know the laws governing the atoms and molecules, I know what how elasticity should work. But that is not the way we do it. That is not the way an engineer would do it. He would be a bad engineer if he does that way. He knows what is Young's modulus, what is the stress and strain relationship of the material, and he works with them. Similarly with fluid mechanics, nobody who does fluid mechanics or aerodynamics of airplane wings worry about the molecular structure of atoms. In the same sort of way, you can write down, just as you can write down gas laws, etc. It turns out that even the gravitational dynamics could be like a fluid mechanics of the atoms of space-time. Imagine that your entire space-time, which you think is a continuum and it is going from place to place, etc., etc., is actually built of some unknown atoms of space-time. Just as this looks enormously smooth, most of it is empty, it is made out of atoms. But you don't see them. In the same way, you don't see the atoms of space-time, but they can be there. And the gravity could be an emergent phenomenon. So if that is the case, then what we need to do is to study gravity exactly the way people studied gas dynamics before they understood the microscopic structure of the atoms. The problem with this is that when people studied the structure of molecules, etc., you could test it experimentally. But what we are talking about is enormously tiny. I just want to bring to you the tininess of that number. In this axis, I have drawn macro scale. This is sun, this is solar system, and this is the edge of the universe. So I have gone from here to, by multiplying by factors, 30 times, 10, 30 times the factor of 10. If I divide by factor of 10, same 30 times, you get here. So this is like the edge of the universe in microscopic physics. To reach up to some grand unified theories, observation stop somewhere over here. The scales we are talking about are here. It is so far removed from everyday physics at the small scale than the edge of the universe is in the larger scale. So that is the problem. So you have to rely on pure theory to understand this. So if you want to do this and you try to use this emergent gravity paradigm, there are some key results which we have obtained. The first result is that the equations which describe gravity are like equations of gas dynamics. And the gravity actually turns out to be immune to shifting around of the energy levels. I said that that is a major problem, and that is taken care of when you do gravity this way. And what is more, just as if you have gas, if you remember your old chemistry, there is something called Avogadro's number for gas. And you can measure something very similar to that for the case of gravity. And that number is given by, you take any area, take 1 square centimeter of area, and you can calculate how many atoms of space-time are there. It turns out to be 10 to the power 66. That is 1 followed by 66 zeros. So there are that many atoms of space-time in 1 square centimeter of area. Okay? So again, the enormity or the smallness of this thing comes up. And you can write down the dynamics of the universe by using how many degrees of freedom exist in a bulk and how many degrees of freedom exist in the surface. So if you take some region of the universe, there is a way of attributing some degrees of freedom which is sitting on the surface. Think of them like atoms which are sitting on the surface. There is some degrees of freedom which is sitting in the bulk region. And whether the region is going to expand, contract, etc., how it will change, depends on this 1 minus n bulk by n. If n bulk is equal to n surface, then this is 0 and nothing happens. This is exactly what happens in the universe. As the universe evolved in the inflationary phase and in the late accelerating phase, the surface and bulk degrees of freedom are equal. That is why the density doesn't change. In between, it is not, and that is what is driving the evolution of the density or the evolution of the curvature. So a completely new picture of the universe emerges in this paradigm, which is described by taking gravity to be similar to something like fluid mechanics. Okay? And just as you can study fluid mechanics without knowing what the atoms of fluid are, just as you can study elasticity, the vibrations of a steel rod, without knowing what the steel atoms are made of, you can study the universe without knowing what are the atoms of space-time are. We don't know that yet. But that does not prevent us from modeling the universe. When you do this, a remarkable relation emerges, which is probably the only equation I want to show you. And you don't have to worry about this. All that you have to go back with is that one density, there are 3 densities here, rho inflation, rho at equality, and rho at lambda. High energy physicists can tell me what is this and what is this. If he tells me these two, I can tell you what the cosmological constant is. I told you that the major theoretical problem today is knowing the value of this cosmological constant. This particular approach tells you how to attack and solve that problem. It gives you a concrete formula by which these things can be connected. And those of you who are sort of mathematically inclined and you know what does EXP stands for will know that This is an extremely tiny number. And that is why that number has this 120 zeros onto it. So you end up getting the very tiny number here by thinking of gravity as something like a fluid mechanics of atoms of space-time. If you do that, you can understand this behavior. Okay? So that is essentially what I want to tell you, but let me just sum up what I have been saying. The first point is that we do understand the evolution of the universe from a fraction of a second to 14 billion years. So for any moderate person, that would be a great achievement. If you are not very ambitious, that is pretty good. 14 million years is a long time. Now, we also understand that the vacuum fluctuations generated during the very early phase of the universe can lead to this kind of structures which we see today. That is also quite well defined, and we understand it. We can compare theory with observations, and we can see what is happening. But when we do the same thing and try to understand the nitty-gritty of the structure formation in the later phase, we find that you need a cosmological constant to contribute nearly 71% of the energy density. And it is this cosmological constant which is accelerating the expansion of the universe. And we do see observational evidence for the acceleration. We know the numerical value of the cosmological constant. This entire thing can be summed up as a tale of three densities, out of which two we understand from high energy physics. One, namely the cosmological constant, is a complete mystery. There we need a paradigm shift. Once you have that paradigm shift, you can think of gravity as an emergent phenomenon, and that is capable of explaining the value of the cosmological constant and why gravity is immune to the shifting. Now, since, as I said, you may be reading other literature, this cosmological constant which I keep referring to is what is popularly called dark energy. Okay? But when you say dark energy, it looks somewhat mysterious and, you know, Dark Vader, Star Wars, this, that, etc. So I don't want to use that word. So it is, observations tell you that it is just a cosmological constant, which is a term in Einstein's equation, and that term needs to be explained. And we believe that we can do it now. So I'll conclude with some acknowledgements. I'll put it up here. Thank you very much.